What I'm going to do is demonstrate my method of making the Bouabsa baguettes. And Bouabsa is named after Anis Bouabsa, who is a baker in Paris. And a few years ago, I think in 2009, he won the All Paris or All France competition for best baguette in the city. And his reward was being able to supply the president of France with baguettes for a year. So pretty good eating for the president. Anyway, these baguettes are long cold fermentation. They use very little yeast. As you'll see, they use commercial yeast, and they do explode in the oven. And when I say explode, I don't mean explode. They just grow quite a bit if you've scored them correctly. So what I'm going to do is take you through the ingredients and the tools that I use, and from there, we'll go into the next segment, which will be actually creating the dough before the cold fermentation. Now, cold fermentation, according to the instructions, is approximately 21 hours. And I don't think there's anything magical about the 21-hour period, except that probably Mr. Bouabsa's schedule in his bakery dictates that 21 hours is the appropriate time before he has to take them out of the oven, bake, and schedule other things. So let's begin with the basic ingredients. And if we go down here, we'll see, I just use plain Pillsbury Best or gold medal flour. I don't use fancy flours. It doesn't matter. Maybe if I used a different flour, I'd get a better result. It's not a bread flour. And so it's pretty much all purpose. It's exactly what it is. And then it's unbleached. And then if we come over here, the commercial yeast I use is a very, very standard commercial yeast for bakeries. It's SAF Instant Red. Yeast bread as opposed to the gold label, which is something else. And this is the commercial yeast I use all the time. Over here is the salt that I used. It's Diamond Crystal Kosher Salt. Now, some people use fancy salts that are harvested by Huguenot dwarves on the shores of Normandy. And maybe they're better, maybe they're not. Same thing with the flour. Some people use King Arthur or other small mill flours. I find that this works. Better flour may work better than this, but this is fine for me. And the last thing is tap water. If you have good tap water, I'm sure you could use that. And those are the basic ingredients: flour, water, salt, yeast. And let's get on to the tools that I use for a mixing bowl. I have this melamine bowl that I use for hand mixing. Everything I do for these baguettes is hand mixed. And when I hand mix them, I use a scraper to scrape down the sides. And I also have a bench knife or a dough scraper for cleaning up either wet or and dried flour or dry flour. I also use cooking spray to lubricate the vessel that the dough that's fermenting in the refrigerator for long cold fermentation. I spray it inside of here, as you'll see. Everything will be demonstrated in the next part. And then I have two different scales. This is a scale that goes by every 5 grams. And so, generally speaking, it's okay. I had it for about 10 years, and if I was doing it over again, I'd buy a more specific scale than that. But because it only goes every 5 grams, I went ahead and purchased a scale that actually does hundredths of a gram, which is overkill. But nonetheless, it lets me bring it down to a very finite level. And I really don't need hundredths of a gram, but as long as it's there, I use it. Here I have gloves. I put these gloves on when I mix. It makes it a lot easier to mix, and the dough doesn't stick to my hands or the hair in the back of my hands. Hair, barely. And I also use these for rolling out the baguettes. It just makes it easier when you're using a high hydration baguette, like the Bouabsa baguettes, which are 75% hydration, which is pretty high. Not as high as they go, but pretty high for a baguette. Over here, for scoring the baguettes, I use standard double-edged razor blades that are available in most supermarkets or pharmacies. And I use a homemade lame. When we moved to Florida, I lost my lame in transition, and so basically I have a homemade lame. And this is an example of how you take a double-edged razor blade and put it on a lame. You want a C-curve, and so I'm going to thread it on. I think a lot of people are a little bit concerned about cutting themselves, but as you can see, here's the curve, relatively easy to see here. Here's the curve. And if you do it carefully and you're not too drunk, you probably won't cut yourself. Make sure you have medicine cabinet available if you do. But I don't think I've ever cut myself putting a blade on or off the lime holder. Next we have, instead of using standard dish towels, I bought a set of dish towels. The reason is the dried dough sticks to the dish towel. If you have a terry towel, it's going to ruin it. So I'd rather ruin these and keep these dedicated for baking. And this is what I use for a number of different steps, as well as washing my hand, wiping my hands down. Anything you want to use, you never bake on baked crumbs in an oven. You always wipe clean and bake clean. And so I always brush the oven out before I bake anything in there. This is a Pyrex baking dish and a standard towel, terry towel. And what I do is, this is going to be what's called Sylvia's steaming towels. This will create a lot of steam in the oven to go along with my other steaming product, which is a pan with lava rocks in it that sits in the oven and gets boiling water poured on top of it. Over here, I use two different baking pans, baking sheets. One of them I use for the couche or the linen when I go ahead and create the baguettes and form them. And then I seat them on the couche, which is lightly floured. And then they sit and they do their final proofing on this baking sheet. I have this thing, which is, I call a hand peel, and it's people call it a flip board, and basically it's used for moving the baguettes from the couche onto the vehicle, the peel that's going to deliver them into the oven. And this here is parchment paper. I use parchment paper because the baguettes are guaranteed to not stick to the peel or this baking sheet. And lastly, if I open the oven and I pull out the bottom drawer, this is the baking pan filled with lava rocks. And this is going to sit in the oven for the better part of an hour while the oven heats up. And this is going to create a lot of thermal mass and also create a lot of steam when I pour boiling water on it. And finally, this is the baking deck itself. It's made from unglazed terracotta tile, and all of the baking is done on there. As soon as I put these in, within the first bake or two, they crack. They've never cracked anymore. These tiles pretty much live on this rack in the oven, and this is what the baguettes will go on, with the piece of parchment paper in between them and the tiles themselves. And that's pretty much everything that I use for creating the baguettes. So I'm going to leave you at this point. The next time I come back to the video, it will be to mix and create the dough and talk about how the dough is made just before it goes in the refrigerator for long cold fermentation. So I'll see you then. So now we're going to mix the dough for the Bouabsa double hydration formula for baguettes. I call it double hydration because I will hydrate most of the water into the flour at the initial stage, and then after the autolyse, I'll add the remaining water. And you'll see that as we go. So the formula that was developed, I want to say this, the formula was developed from Mr. Bouabsa by two individuals who are on the Fresh Loaf website. That's David Snyder and a woman by the name of Jane. So David Snyder goes by DM Snyder, and Jane goes by J-E-N-E-D-O. I don't know if that's Janedo or Jane Doe. Nonetheless, they're the ones who originated this. I want to attribute the formula to them. And of course, as things go on, people change things slightly. Nonetheless, this is theirs. So what we're going to start with is, we have the Pillsbury Best Unbleached All-Purpose Flour. There's 570 grams of that. And to that, I'm going to add 0.91 grams of SAF Red Label Instant Dried Yeast. It isn't a true autolyse because I am adding the yeast before ordering. So now all I'm going to do is mix it up by hand. Just incorporate the instant dried yeast into the flour. Now I'm going to do the first portion of the double hydration of water. I'm going to add all but maybe 50 grams of water. I have 425 grams of water total. That's about right. And now I'm going to just gently turn to mix the dough. All I want to do is moisten the dough before I start pinching and folding, if I may be able to fold at all. And this is what's going to precede the autolyse. If you're careful, you don't get pieces like this flying. Usually I don't. You probably want to do a little bit more than this, just to make sure it's the water is completely incorporated and you're saturating the flour. And then what I'm going to do, I'll finish mixing it for another moment. What you're going to do is cover it, set your timer for about 30 minutes, and then come back at that point. So we'll return at that point. The autolyse has now been going on for about 30 minutes, and so we've given the chance for the flour to be saturated by the water that I've placed in so far, the first portion of the double hydration of the water, and at this point some gluten strands should be forming. So now I'm going to take the cover off, and this is what the dough looks like right now. It's a very low hydration. Overall it will be a 75% hydration dough, so it'll be pretty high for a baguette. Typical baguettes in commercial bakeries probably are in the vicinity of the upper 60s and probably infrequently reach 70% hydration. So now I'm going to add the remaining water. And the salt. And now I'm going to do the same thing as I did before. Now it'll take a little longer for this to be incorporated because there is a lot of water to be absorbed. And so I'm just going to keep on doing this until this gets absorbed. If it looks a little too wet, I'm going to give it about 5 minutes just to sit on its own. And when that is done, we'll be back and I'll go into the next step, which is called French fold. And that happens on the workbench. And the workbench, by the way, I always attempt to keep the workbench clean for any baking, of course, cooking. I think it's essential that you keep this area as clean as possible. So we'll be back when it's ready for a French fold. So now we've incorporated all of our ingredients and let it sit for about 5 minutes after full pinching and folding. It's really hard to do a pinch and fold, just a pinch until all the ingredients came together. It was a little wet. So now I'm going to take the cover off and I'm going to take the ingredients that are in here. So this is now after all the ingredients have been sitting here for about 5 minutes. I'm going to take them out and put them onto my clean workbench. Squeeze out the remainder. Okay. And this is approximately what your dough should look like. You can see it's very shaggy. That's a term that I seem to see a lot on the fresh loaf, is a shaggy mass. So I'll use that term for this. You can see it's very shaggy. It has no structure. It's just a bunch of goop. So what I'm going to do is show the French fold now. And this is a method to incorporate air and also a number of folds to start developing and strengthen the gluten. So what we need to do, and do this the first 10 or 15 or 20 very carefully, or you'll be picking dough off of everything in your kitchen. So I'm going to drop it down and fold it on itself. Come over here, fold it on itself. You can see what kind of a mass it is, but you'll see what will happen in about 10 of these folds. It's 3, 4. So you see, in just a matter of 10 folds, you can see how it's already started to come together. So the way I'm going to do this is I'm going to pick it up from the sides like this, come underneath it, pick it up, drop it down, and fold it on itself, and kind of pull the ends out a little bit. And this takes a little practice to get down. Pick it up on its sides, slap it down. The more it comes together, the harder you could slap. One of the funny things about this is after about 100 of these folds, what happens is the dough seems to kind of like loosen up again. It feels like you're losing it. It's just one of the characteristics. Eventually the dough will tighten up again. Now, I do about 300 of these French folds. So as I get close to the end, we'll start filming again and you'll see what it looks like when I'm done. But let me just show you a few more. Pick it up from the sides, slap it down, fold it over itself, try to incorporate some air. Don't worry about all this goop out here. That could be scraped off with a bench knife. And I wouldn't worry about it, it'll dry. So I'm just gonna keep on going and we'll turn the camera off and the better part of 300 more. And you can hear the slap already. This is how quickly it comes together. And eventually we'll have something that actually looks like a dough, but incomplete. So we'll see you when this is close to about 300 of these folds. So this is about after about 290 of these French folds. I'm going to do about another 10. You'll see there's a halo of dried dough around here. I wouldn't worry about it because it's not going to be picked up by this mass. So just do the final 10. And you can see the characteristic of the dough has changed significantly. So grab from the side, pick up, slap down, pull out and over. And after about 300, I put it into this container which has canola oil spray in it. And that is where it's going to sit over the course of the next day with a couple of letter folds in between. I just want to emphasize that this is my technique. It's nothing that's strictly mine, but this is just the way I've developed it. There are multiple right ways to do this, and probably multiple wrong ways to do this as well. You can see how easily this dried dough comes off. If you want to learn more about French folds, there are plenty of videos out on the web. There's a long one by a woman by the name of Baguette. It's in Spanish, but it does have English overdub on it, so you can see that. And we're going to let this sit now for 20 minutes, and we're going to do 3 sets of letter folds 20 minutes apart before it goes into the refrigerator for 21 to 24 hours. So we'll be back in about 20 minutes. It's now been 20 minutes since we completed the French folds and put it into this container, which I've covered. The container had canola oil sprayed in the bottom. I don't know if it matters what kind of oil it is. I just happen to like canola oil spray. And just the same as we saw the amazing transformation from the time that it came out of the mixing bowl until the time that it went into this container, we're also going to see a transformation now in a matter of a mere 20 minutes. So cover comes off. What I do is moisten my hands and I spread water on my work surface so that the dough doesn't stick. That's all it takes. Turn this over. And now what we're going to do is called letter folds. And we're going to try to do 6 letter folds the first, definitely the first time. So now you'll see the extensibility of this dough just like that. You can see how it glistens and it extends. So fold it over, pull it out, fold it over by a third. Pull this side, pick it up, pull it out, fold it over by a third. Take this side, pull it out, fold it over by a third. And you can see how the dough glistens and how extensible it is in just a matter of 20 minutes. And I'm going to try to get 2 more folds out of this. So I'll turn it, and again fold it, and now I can't fold it again, so I'm just going to roll it. And drop it back in here again, close the cover, set the timer for another 20 minutes, and do the same thing 2 more times. And that's it. 20 minutes have passed. We're on the second of the 3 letter folds. So, take the cover off, moisten my hands, moisten the work surface. Again, there should be more extensibility, but now because the dough is starting to rise, it's not quite as easy to fold as we saw before. So that's 1 set of letter folds. In this set, that's 2, and I really can't go further, but I'm going to try to like just fold it up. Just roll it up like this. Let's see how it glistens, how extensible it was before. Very much different than when we first finished our stretch and folds. Cover goes back on. last 20 minutes before it goes into the retarder or refrigerator for overnight fermentation, and that'll be about 21 to 24 hours. So that's it. We'll see you for the third. Last stretch and fold. This is now 60 minutes that the dough has been rising, fermenting. So you can see, although I didn't do this before, you can probably see that there's a slight dome forming because the dough is quite active now. What I'm going to do is moisten the cleaned workbench one more time. Dump this out. One more time, I'm going to do a stretch and fold. You can see now how it's much chubbier than it was before. So there's my letter fold. There's my second letter fold for stretch and fold. And here, I'm going to have trouble doing more than that again because the dough is rising. But now you can see how extensible the dough is, and it's going to sit like this inside of the refrigerator or the retarder for 21 to 24 hours. And at that point, I'll take it out and I'll warm it up for about 45 minutes before we resume, and then it's going to be time to divide and start shaping the baguettes. So one last thing. I just want to spray a little bit of cooking spray on top to keep it moist and try not to use it as an ingredient, but rather as a moisturizer when it's into the refrigerator. We're back at day two now, so we've let the Bouabsa dough ferment for about 21-22 hours in the refrigerator. I took it out about 45 minutes ago. My kitchen is a little warmer than many other kitchens. Even with the air conditioning, it's about 78 to 80 degrees. If you have a cooler kitchen, maybe you want it at, let the dough sit for about an hour before you deal with it. So it's been sitting out in bulk, and here's what it looks like. So you can see that there's definitely more of a rise than the ones when we put in the refrigerator yesterday. And now I'm going to divide it. And the dough is going to divide into three baguettes for pre-shaping, each about 310 grams apiece. So the first thing I'll do is I flour the bench here a little bit, another clean bench. Take the dough out. Now I'm going to divide it into three, approximately 310 grams apiece. See how close I can get. That's 310. That's 270. Big difference. 355. Slop off a piece. 310, 315. Okay, so that's all I needed the scale for. Put the scale aside, and now we're going to pre-shape. I'm going to pre-shape it in the kind of a shape I want it eventually to be for a baguette. So I just want to dust off any additional flour that got on there. And now here it is, and people will say getting all kinds of different shapes to start. This is fine for me, so all I'm going to do is take it. Gently, but firmly, and that's what I want to do is a pre-shape, so that's one. If you have to divide your dough into multiple pieces, try to not make it more than three pieces. This is two, and that's fine. Same thing. Roll it, little roll, gently but firmly. That's two. So it looks kind of like a torpedo or batard at the moment. Test off any additional flour, same thing. Roll it into approximately the same shape. So now I've got the three baguettes in their pre-shaped form. I'm gonna cover them so that they don't dry out and they don't get any air blowing across them. And this is gonna sit for about 15 minutes, and then after that, we'll shape them into baguettes. And so 15 minutes will start now on my timer. So we are just shy of the 15 minutes for the pre-shaping of the baguettes to complete, but I didn't want to make mention of this. This is what we referred to before as Sylvia steaming baguettes, steaming towels. Basically, it's a terry towel rolled up inside of an oven-proof dish, in this case, Pyrex dish. And as you can see, I filled it with enough water that it's not going out of water. I'm going to create steam. And about 15 minutes before I put the baguettes into the oven, I will put this in the oven with very hot water that'll create from heating these up in the microwave. And this will pre-steam the oven before I put the baguettes in, and then the lava rock tray will continue making more steam once the baguettes go in. So I just want to put this aside now. And the oven should heat up for about 45 to 60 minutes. Just after we cut the last video, I turned the oven on. The oven's now at 480, so it's been on for about 10 minutes. We need that amount of time for not just the oven to heat up, but also for the baking deck and the lava rock and pan that are sitting in to heat sufficiently. So we're about 15 minutes, and now I'm going to remove the towel. And here are the three pre-shaped baguettes. What I'm going to do is I clean this area off here with my bench knife. I'm just going to put a very light dusting of flour on here. We really don't want too much flour on these baguettes, otherwise it's not incorporated into the dough. It's just going to look, if you like a rustic look, that's one thing. I'm trying to not have that rustic look when I don't have to. So just a little flour. Take the first baguette, turn it so that the seam side is up, kind of square it away. And a lot of videos do, and teachers do this completely different, bakers do this completely differently. This is the way I learned it, this is the way I do it. I basically take the baguette pre-shape and roll it over on itself once and press firmly, but not too firmly, twice, three times, and then a fourth time, what I do is pinch it closed at the seam, and this is what it now looks like. Okay, so it's already got some length, it's already got some shape, and now I'm going to finish shaping it as a baguette. A baguette in enough size to fit into my oven, which is shorter than an actual baguette. Just dust my hands a little bit, and then start rolling gently. And now you see the seam is still up. It's got generally the baguette shape, a little bit torpedo in the center. Pick it up so the seam side is down. And I'm going to place it on this couche. So the couche over here is pre-dusted. I'm going to put a line of dust over here for the second baguette, so it doesn't stick, although it shouldn't stick to a good linen couche anyway. Pull this up over here so it creates like a channel for it. And now it's time for the second baguette. Just a little bit of dust on the counter, turn it over so it's seam side up, flatten it a little bit, make it kind of square, rectangular-ish, grab it at the far end, pull up, press down firmly, but not too firmly, second time, third time, and fourth time is where I'm going to actually pinch the seam closed, and there it is, the seam is up, and now dust my hand slightly, and roll out with pressure, but not too much pressure, but I don't degas the baguette too much. Now we've turned it to seam side is down, and move it over to here to the couche. Pull the couche up to make a channel. Grab some dust, which is flour, and just very lightly dust it. Same thing again with the third baguette. Dust the workbench, seam side up. One, two, three, four, pinch it closed, seam side up, and that's a third baguette. Okay, that's all I'm going to do because that's all I have. Now what I'm going to do is I'm taking close this side of the couche, and close this side of the couche to completely enclose it. And now this is going to sit and do what's called the final proofing for about 35 minutes, maybe a little less, and I'll bring it away from the oven, which is now getting a little heat. Okay, and in between that, then and, that, and now and when they're ready to be moved onto the onto the baking peel for the final entry into the oven is we're just going to let it sit and just do a little bit of the prep work for that. So we'll be back in about 35 minutes. It's a little less than 30 minutes, and I'm going to do a finger dent test, which is pretty standard. Basically what I'm going to do, you could see that the proofing has filled them out. They're a little larger than they were before. Basically, you can take a floured finger, basically just press it about a half inch into the baguette. If it pops back up, it's underproofed. If it doesn't return at all, it's overproofed. And if it rises slowly as it is now, it's about proofed. So I'm going to say that these are proofed and they're ready to be moved onto with the hand peel onto the peel that's going to bring them into the oven. I'll just close this for a second. And if we come over here, I put Sylvia's steaming towel into the oven before, and I don't know if you could see it. It had about a 15-minute head start, and it's starting to steam now, so it's creating good steam for the oven already, even if you can't see the steam specifically. Okay. Now it's time to move these onto the final peel. I've got my parchment paper, transfer peel. Let's do it this way. Okay, so I'm going to take and pull this out to get rid of the first channel. Press this against. Transfer it on here. And then, this is a little longer. Straighten it out. Second one. Transfer it onto the parchment paper. And the third one, flip it over. Transfer on the parchment paper. Try to give them as much room as possible so that the side walls of each one has enough room to have heat around it. So this is what we have now. And the next step is going to be to score these. And the way I score them is, again, here is the C curve that I showed you before the start of going over the equipment in this blade. And scoring is, and David Snyder on the Fresh Loaf has an excellent video on how to do scoring. So he's DM Snyder on thefreshloaf.com, and you can find his video, and it goes in detail about what I'm going to do. But generally speaking, I'm going to try to make four cuts basically across the center of the top, and each one at a slight angle, and with the blade held at a slight angle, and only the tip of the blade facing in and cutting in through the baguette. Now, I don't want the blade to drag, so I'm going to cheat a little bit. I've got some olive oil here. I'm just going to dip the blade in the olive oil. And then I'm going to come across and score these four down, each one a little overlapping on each. That's one. That's two. And that's three. And that's all we have. So now, these are now going to go into the oven. And in order to do that, I've got some boiling water here. I'll press the boiling water. I'm going to put 2 cups of water onto the lava rocks after the baguettes go in. And this is the step where you want to be really careful. There's an awful lot of heat going on here. So I put on my gloves, open the oven door. It's going to lose a little bit of heat. And take a terry towel and put it across the glass, because if boiling water hits that glass, the glass is 480 degrees, the glass will probably crack, and you'll be crying the blues and buying a new glass for your oven. Okay, I'm just going to take these and slide these onto the oven deck, pull out the shelf with the lava rocks. You'll see steam immediately. Away, put it back in, close the oven door. It's 480 degrees, starting my timer at 12 minutes, and we'll come back in about 12 minutes to open the door, release the remaining steam, and turn the baguettes around and shift their position in the oven so they bake equally. So we'll see. 12 minute mark now, and the timer went off, and so just up here, I have the linens that I've scraped of the extra flour, and that they're drying off on here. I'm going to open up the oven now, being careful because there is a lot of steam still being generated. And the first thing I want to do is I want to stop the steam at this point. So I'm going to take out the steaming towels. All of the water that I poured on the lava racks has long ago dissipated. And now I'm going to be taking the baguettes out halfway through. You can see the inner walls don't bake as well because even though they're a distance apart, they're still too close. I'm taking out the parchment paper because as thin as it is, it still acts as a buffer in between the hot baking stone and an insulator and the baguettes. And I've turned them around. I've turned them 180 degrees and moved them around the oven. Close the oven door quickly. And I'm going to set the timer for 8 minutes and see how they're doing. I like a dark bake. And so once the 8 minutes are up, I'll take a look at them and see if I want them dark, which I probably will, and let them bake a little more. And we'll be back. Okay, so I took the baguettes out of the oven after 20 minutes. Sometimes they take 22 minutes. The last half minute or so, I leave the oven door open so that the you can get some fresh air and the oven temperature will drop a little as they kind of dry out. I've scored better, I've scored worse. These are pretty good. So before when I was talking about they explode in the oven, I was basically talking about this kind of scoring. Sometimes they score way better than this. I'm happy with this.
About a day and a half later, I decided to bake another batch of Bouabsas. And this is one of the things about the bread. So here is what I baked last evening. And you'll notice that it's a little misshapen. I think there was a little too much humidity in the kitchen. One of the things about Bouabsas, you'll see from the pictures that I've put onto this video, is sometimes the shaping is a little unusual and inconsistent. I don't think it's me because I've made these too many times. When I open it up, you can see that there is some open crumb here. And then there's closed because you can see how this is constricted. This just didn't bloom as much. In general, it's probably going to taste just as good. It'll just be that the crumb is a little denser there. I've had them open up more, as you'll see on pictures. But generally speaking, this is another example of the finished product. So when I cut these open eventually, which shouldn't be for at least 20 minutes, I should see some nice open crumb inside. And that's about it. So this is a pretty comprehensive way to make the Bouabsa double hydration baguettes. And I hope that I've achieved where I wanted to, which was to walk you through from soup to nuts or from bread to nuts, how to make these baguettes. And that's it.